Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our B tonight. Welcome to our revitalised hall as well. There's nothing that a fresh lick of brown paper can't do to freshen up the place and the foyer as we walk in. Tonight we have Phil continuing our Israel series, and he's going to particularly look at 1967, the Six-Day War. So tonight we'll start a little bit differently. We are going to start with HaTikvah, or Hat, as it is affectionately called by those in the know on the hymn board. Phil is encouraging us that we sing it in Hebrew as well. So brush off your and all your other Hebrew accents that you got, and try and sing the left-hand side, because that fits the music. The English doesn't actually fit. It's a transliteration. So we're going to start with hymn and prayer, and our opening hymn, if it's called that, or song, is HaTikvah. Let's pray. Great God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, you who looked after them through the generations and their seed, we come before you thanking you for your long suffering, thanking you for your mercy that you have on your children and on the generations that follow after Abraham. And we thank you particularly at this time, Father, that we can be grafted into that fig tree, that we can be part of that family, that we can be part of your children. So, Father, please help us to appreciate the time that we have tonight. Appreciate the time where we can reflect on your work in the nations, how you have brought about your events and to your timeline. Please help us, Father, to appreciate that, because that gives us confidence that all the other things you promise in your Bible you'll bring together in our lives. That day when there will be peace in Jerusalem, when the whole world will be at rest and your glory will flow like the waters. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray at this time. Amen. We'll be taking a reading tonight from Luke 21, and we'll get Dave to read verses 5 to 36 for us. Thanks for that, Dave.
Reading with you, Luke chapter 21, from verses 5 to 36. And as some spake of the temple, how it was adorned with goodly stones and gifts, he said, As for these things which ye behold, the days will come in the which there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And they asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be? And what signs will there be when these things shall come to pass? And he said, Take heed that ye be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the time draweth near. Go ye not therefore after them. But when ye shall hear of wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these things must first come to pass, but the end is not by and by. Then said he unto them, Nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven. But before all these, they shall lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. And it shall turn to you for a testimony. Settle it therefore in your hearts, not to meditate before what ye shall answer, for I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. And ye shall be betrayed both by parents and brethren and kinsfolks and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but there shall not an hair of your head perish. In your patience possess ye your souls. And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. For there shall be great distress in the land, and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And he spake to them a parable. Behold, the fig tree and all the trees, when they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man.
Thanks, Brother Dave, and good evening, Brethren and sisters, young people, friends. Now, as you came in, there should have been a handout on the sheet on the door just inside. If anyone hasn't got one, put your hand up and we'll get the doorman to bring him around. Thanks, Uncle Trev. All right, so maybe the younger ones, if we can get them down here to Austie. Make sure the younger ones have all got one. I don't think there'll be anything too amazing for the older ones, other than the very fact itself, what we're talking about, which of course is amazing. Okay, great. I think we're ready. Thanks, Uncle Trev. And let's get into this exciting prophecy about the modern nation of Israel, which we've just read about. So in Luke 21, we start off with this picture of Jesus on the Mount of Olives looking down at the temple where the Jews worshipped. It was gold, it was beautiful, it was solid, massive stones, precious without price. As far as they were concerned, it would never be removed. And yet Jesus sat down and gave them the prophecy which we just read. And it reads about a lot of wars, a lot of discomfort, a lot of problems, a lot of trial, a lot of distress, doesn't it? And really, I guess, it becomes relevant to us because that's very much a sign of the end of an age. And we believe we're in that end of the age. And the sign we're going to look at tonight is one of the reasons why we believe we're at the end of the age that is waiting for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what we're going to do is just work our way through Luke 21 briefly up front, just to get a bit of an understanding of what we've just read. So I hope to get a bit of interaction here on question number one. So about what time period was Jesus making this prophecy? What time was he living in when he spoke these words? So when was the ministry of Jesus? What year? So about 30 to 33 AD. Okay, so when Jesus' ministry was lived on this earth. So he's making this prophecy, and as I said, he was looking at a temple that was permanent, that the Jews never thought would be destroyed. But we know that that happened. We know that that happened. Which nation compassed and destroyed Jerusalem in AD 70, like it describes there in verse 20? Laurie? Romans. Well done. Do you know what the name of the generals were? No? Anyone? For bonus points. Titus? Right, okay. Hope this is awake for me. Okay, so the general Titus. So you probably remember in many talks we've spoken about the taking of Jerusalem by the Romans. It happened in two parts, didn't it? The first part was by Vespasian. Then he drew back and went to Rome to the Caesar. And his son came and took over. His son's name was Titus. Titus was the one who destroyed Jerusalem in AD 70. And the temple, particularly itself, was pulled down, not one stone left upon another, just like Jesus prophesied. Now, we can go to an arch, a physical stone arch, which we've got up there on the PowerPoint, and we can see recorded for us by archaeologists, I guess, in this monument that was built in recognition of Titus's work. We see there the Jews being taken away with the candelabra or menorah that was known to be in the temple and many other aspects from the temple on the shoulders of Rome. It's there, it's physical, we know that it happened. And so often we go back to that and say, look, this is a reliable proof of the Bible, a prophecy made by Jesus almost 40 years before it happened. In AD 70, and Rome came, and Rome destroyed that temple and took away Israel into captivity. So that's the first part of the prophecy which excites us. But then there's a second part to this prophecy that continues on and starts to get closer to our time period today. How long was Jerusalem suppressed by Gentile nations, or trodden down, as it says in verse 24? Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Anyone know? About 1900 years, isn't it? And the last couple of nights that we've been through looking at the nation of Israel, we've seen that evidence really sticking out and being proven to us. Here's a sample of maps from the year 1000 BC through to, what have we got there, 1960 AD. And we look here from this period, if we start looking when Rome came and took over Jerusalem, the Ottoman Empire, right through until 1967, there's no land of Israel. 1967 is not right, sorry. There's no land of Israel up until 1948, which is what we spoke about last year, last week. The War of Independence. And there, during that period of time, we've got a whole list of different Gentile nations, nations which aren't Jews, who ruled over Jerusalem and had control over it. The Romans, the Byzantine, the Muslims, the Crusaders, the Mamluks, the Ottoman Turks, the British Mandate, which Steve touched on, and finally the Jordanians, which we spoke about last week in the War of Independence. The Jordanians who came and took the city complete. And this memory stuck with one of the soldiers of the IDF. I want to introduce you to this man because he becomes interesting as we follow through the history we're going to look at tonight. This man was Yitzhak Rabin. On the 28th of May 1948, right near the beginning of the War of Independence, smoke was rising over Jerusalem again. We just saw photos, didn't we? Or pictures of AD 70, that smoke. It was something that went along with that city right through its history. A young Jewish commander, Yitzhak Rabin, stood on Mount Zion, looking down as the synagogues and houses of the old city burned. There was nothing he could do about it. His men had tried. Now, Yitzhak Rabin, you might have remembered, when we spoke about the road that was going from Latrun up to Jerusalem, and right before the start of the War of Independence, Israeli Palmach, or the Special Operations Squad of the Haganah, were able to capture that road and to open up that path to Jerusalem to ensure that the Jews there in Jerusalem could be looked after. And he was the one that led that mission. Yet when it came to conquering Jerusalem again and taking it back from the Jordanians, he failed. And that was burnt in his brain in 1948 as a memory, because when the Jews came back to the land of Israel, to the land of Palestine, the thing that they really wanted to take as their heart was this city, the city of Jerusalem. But in 1948, they failed. Here's a really interesting quote. From David Ben-Gurion, the father of the re-establishment of Israel. No city in the world, not even Athens or Rome, ever played a greater role in the life of a nation for so long a time as Jerusalem has done in the life of the Jewish people. Does anyone know who that picture is on the right, meant to be portraying? Three times a day, he opened the windows. Yep. Daniel, exactly, when he was in captivity in Babylon, didn't he? Three times a day, he would open his windows and he would pray towards Jerusalem because his people were in captivity. And he longed for the time when they'd go back and possess that city. It went far greater in time period than that, didn't it? But there's just one example in the overall generations where the heart of the Jew looked back to Jerusalem and longed for it again to be the heart and the home of their people. Let's continue to work our way through these questions that we've got to. So we're up to, why is Jerusalem connected with the second coming of Jesus? So you'll see there that we've just read through about the destruction of Jerusalem until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled in verse 24. And then immediately we go on to a section which is about the coming of the Son of Man. Signs and the sun, the moon and the stars. Men's hearts failing them for fear until verse 27. Then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. So why is Jerusalem connected with the second coming of Jesus? Any ideas? What do we know will be set up in Jerusalem? Yep, Charles. His kingdom, okay. Especially his throne, isn't it? In fact, there's a really interesting little story about Jerusalem, and it's bound up in the name of Jerusalem. Does anyone know what Jerusalem means in Hebrew? Anyone know down the front? What does Jerusalem mean? Salem means peace. And Yara Shalem, yep. God's peace, not quite. But it's in understanding, it's smack on actually. Yep. Anyone else? Yara. Not quite. Pointer, sometimes we say vision of peace. So this word here, Uncle Jeff will love me. Circling and breaking up the Hebrew. There he is up the back, Uncle Jeff. So Yara means a pointer. So literally it can be used in the context of an archer who takes an arrow and he points at the target, and it's that pointing which is Yara. Or it's also used as a teacher. So just like we're working out here on the whiteboard and pointing and instructing. So it's a pointer towards peace. Now, Psalm says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Okay? But the peace of Jerusalem isn't just a peace of an absence of war. It's the peace of the Bible. It's God's peace, just like you said, Wills. And God's peace is about overcoming sin and death, isn't it? It's the binding again back to God. So everything about this city reminds us that God has a purpose, a grand purpose with all men on this earth. And this city and this people are being used as an example to point to the fact that God is working towards that peace. And so Jerusalem is connected to the reign of Jesus Christ because he is the one that comes back and restores that peace, isn't it? It's the city of the great king in Matthew chapter 5. And if you want to write a few notes in your margin just here on the handout, we've got a paragraph that says that the Jews returned to the land promised by God to the patriarchs, and Jerusalem into the hands of Israel are a witness to the nearness of Jesus' second coming. He will rule for God in the city of the great king, Matthew 5, to bring the peace of Jerusalem, Psalm 122, verse 6, to the earth and set up a city of worship and righteous rule where all nations are invited to come up, Zechariah 14 and Isaiah 2. So that's what Jerusalem is about. That is the vision, that is the teaching of peace. That's why it's connected to the return of Jesus Christ to the earth. So in the reading we've just said, in verse 29 then, Jesus goes on to give a parable about a fig tree. He speaks to them about the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, verse 30, you see and know of your own selves that summer is nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. So if we want to know these signs and find out how near the kingdom of God is, then we want to understand what this parable is about. And the first thing we want to identify in this parable is, well, what are trees used as symbols of in the Bible? Anyone think of what the symbol of a tree might be? Bad trees and good trees, yeah. Not quite what I was looking for. In Exodus 15, verse 27, the nation of Israel came to a place called Elim. And there were 12 wells and 70 palm trees that were around it. The 12 wells spoke of the nation of Israel. The palm trees that were around it spoke about the nations. So in the Bible, there's just one example of where trees are used as symbols of nations. Now, we're interested not just in trees, but in verse number 6, what is the fig tree? So not just nations, but a nation. The fig tree used to represent the nation of, have a guess, Wills? Almost. Jerusalem isn't the nation. Jerusalem's a city. Yeah, another guess. Israel. Okay, the nation of Israel. Well done. The nation of Israel. If you're taking a few notes here, Hosea 9 verse 10. Jeremiah 24, verse 1 to 5, and Luke 13, verse 6 to 7. So the fig tree becomes a symbol of the nation of Israel itself. Now, these trees do something. It says there that they start in verse 30 to shoot forth. Now, what do you think that's describing? What's happening with a tree if it shoots? Yeah? Oh, you've answered heaps. Anyone else? If you go out into your garden and you've planted a seed and it shoots, what does it mean? Parks? Starts to sprout, starts to look alive, doesn't it? Okay. So, really meaning if it's shooting forth, it's coming alive. Okay, so we have a fig tree, which is a symbol of the nation of Israel, which is starting to sprout and to come alive. When we see that, then we know that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Now, we've just spoken about a nation that has been dead for 1900 years, didn't have a homeland, had a people, had a personality, but didn't have a homeland. And we've spoken in the War of Independence how those people had a home. They could come to a place and they could make it live. In 1948, as we spoke about last week, the people of Israel were finally recognized to have an international homeland in 1948. They didn't just conquer the land that was given to them in the resolution of 181, but they took more because they expected more people to be able to come into that land to have a home. And immigration was now in their control, and that growth happened. It started to come alive. And once more, God would have a witness that people could look around the earth and see a nation that was an example of his faithfulness, of his truth, of his working purpose towards a sure end. That sure end, of course, is the kingdom of God, isn't it? So now we get into a little bit of history as we will follow this story through and bring it to life. So following 1948 and the War of Independence, in the 1950s, then, the immigration started to increase into the land of Israel, as I just said. And there up on the screen, we've got pictures of what the immigrant camps were like. They were coming in, of course, faster than they could build. They didn't have the infrastructure and the people to build cities for these places, people to go to. And so immigrant camps were set up. Now, these camps would house 35,000 people initially in 1948. By the time it got to 1951, they were housing 220,000 people. Now, you remember, in 1948, roughly the population of Israel was about 800,000. So here we are adding to it pretty much a fifth, isn't it, by 220,000 that are living in these immigrant camps. So what's happening then to get them to move from those camps out into a nation that was starting to come alive? Well, this is the culture of what was called the kibbutz, the agricultural villages, where the people would get banded together or they would get sent to work and to till the ground. And the most important thing on that slide is that they were people with a fiery ideological and motivational drive to settle the land. Remember the promises to Abraham? That you could walk in this land. This people had those promises in their heart. They wanted to settle this land and make it a land that was known to be the land of the people of Israel. Now, along with that, of course, comes prime ministers, comes leaderships, comes vision. And David Ben-Gurion, as we've spoken about, really is seen as the father of the rebirth of the nation of Israel. His foresight really was a gift that God had given, a right man at the right time. Now, amongst that, while he was dealing with immigration, while he was dealing with the political setting up of a nation, while he was dealing with the United Nations, while he was dealing with the conflict that was happening around him, he was thinking about how he could use the individual talents of people that were arriving as immigrants to best suit that nation and to grow it. Now, we see there not a lot of prime ministers necessarily, but David Ben-Gurion is setting quite a lofty platform there, isn't he, from 1948 through to 1961, of about 13 years leading that nation in its formative time. A short break in the middle there, but pretty much he had that stranglehold and direction of where that nation was growing into. 1963 to 1966 is where we're going to focus on shortly with the Six-Day War, Levi Eshkol. But notice there in 1974 to 1977, Yitzhak Rabin, again, that young soldier that looked down over Jerusalem that had been taken by Jordan and he couldn't recapture it, becomes the prime minister of that nation. That was the quality of the people that were in the military forces of the IDF. They were there to ensure that a homeland was maintained for the nation of Israel. Well, part of securing a nation amongst enemies, because that's all you could say that the Arabs were. They were there to strive to push Jerusalem into the sea, and not Jerusalem, Israel into the sea to overcome them. David Ben-Gurion in 1949 quickly identified that what they needed to survive was intelligence. And it's well known, isn't it, the Mossad, for many remarkable things, I guess. It's got a legacy or almost a whisper that goes with its name of very successful intelligence people. When they started in 1949, it was with the proverb taken from Proverbs 24, verse 6, for by stratagem you wage war, or literally by intelligence. And their motto was to bring justice to those who have harmed the Jewish people, to neutralize military threats to the state of Israel, to retaliate against the perpetrators of terror, and to help Jewish refugees reach the land of Israel. Now, a couple of classic stories that we haven't got long to sort of tell, but to make you aware, you might like to follow in, is bringing to justice those who have harmed the Jewish people. I have a name up there, Adolf Eichmann. Adolf Eichmann was a key of the Nazi group that formed the plan of the Holocaust, the extermination of the Jewish people. At the end of World War II, he escaped and disappeared. When all those that were involved in it were brought to trial, he was nowhere to be found. But burned deep into the heart of the people that returned to Israel was the fact that he had taken the lives of so many of their family members. And he was searched worldwide until he was found hiding in Argentina. And the Mossad were given the task of bringing him back, knowing that if they were caught under international law, they themselves would be put to death. But they took it upon themselves to find him, to capture him. Just happened to coincide it with a delegation that had gone to Argentina on Israel Air Force's air travel to dress him up as a host there, as a hostie, and brought back to Israel to be brought to justice by the courts in Israel. They were there to neutralize the military threats against the state of Israel. Now, a very humbling story to the Syrians was that a man that was known as the master spy, Eli Cohen, was actually a Mossad agent who managed to get almost up to the point of being established as a minister in the Syrian army. In the Syrian politics. He had the information all about the Golan Heights, where the military were placed on the Golan Heights, He had input into how they were disguised. He suggested that perhaps a good addition to their dugouts would be the humble eucalypt tree to give them shade. Now that comes back in the story a bit later. He was found eventually and he was killed for being that infiltrator, I guess, or bringing back that information to Israel. But it became critical information that was used in the Six-Day War in 1967. Another operation which is of very much interest is Operation Diamond. You see there, the Operation Diamond was carried out in 1966, 1 year before the Six-Day War. Now, the Arab nations that were around Israel that were bent on their destruction were getting funded and given arms by the Soviet Union. And perhaps one of the most advanced fighters that was being given to the Arab nations was the MiG-21. The Mossad were given the task of somehow getting a MiG-21 into the hands of the Israel AIF so that they could pull it to bits and work out how it worked, its weaknesses, its strengths. And they managed to find an Iraqi pilot who was disenchanted, who they managed to get to fly his MiG-21 into Israel. And there they were pulling it to bits and understanding the weapons of who was going to be the enemy just a year before it turned true. That was the Mossad. And you can see though, even though we glorify what some of the things they were doing, really there are people that were trusting in their own hand, weren't they? And we spoke about last week, that heart that has to be changed. So they've got they're back in the land, they've got the right spirit to build the nation, but they're still very much relying on their own cunning and their own strength, isn't it? So I guess we always remember that as we go through these stories in the back of our head. Now, parallel to some of this building of the nation of Israel, we've got another story which is coming along as well, and it has its roots too, back in the battle for Israel's independence. But this is an Egyptian commander. An Egyptian commander who lasted out, and I'm not sure if you can remember in the timelines we spoke about last time, there was like about a four-month period at the end of the War of Independence where there was a small group of Egyptians that hung out in the Gaza area or Fajula area, which I've got circled just there, refusing to surrender. And one of those men was Gamal Abdel Nasser, or Nasser. He was involved in the discussions with the British interims. He was actually, he went out to lunch with a certain commander of the Israeli IDF called Yitzhak Rabin at the same time. Anyone remember that name? I think I've brought it up a few times, haven't I? So these two men knew each other and had been involved in some form since 1949, an Israeli commander and an Egyptian commander. Well, Abdel Nasser went on to hold a coup against the Egyptian monarchy of the time, and he took over the presidency of Egypt from 1956 to 1970. And he became the one that became the chief rallier of the anti-Semitic feelings against Israel in the Arab nations. Now, in 1956, what's known as the Suez Crisis, this came to a climax. So Israel is growing as a nation in the land of Palestine. The Suez Canal, which has been in the news recently, I guess, is a pivotal path for boats to go through from the Red Sea through into the Mediterranean. It takes off about 10 days of travel, or else you'd have to go around the bottom of Africa. Now, Egypt did not have control of that Suez Canal. It was an international waterway. It was used by all nations, particularly the Americans, but even the Israelis at that time to get cargo and things through to Tel Aviv and Haifa. And remembering that down the bottom of the, and we'll see in a map a bit, in a little bit, the port of Eilat, which sort of tied the top and the north and the south of Israel together. Well, the Egyptians decided that they were actually going to take over the Suez Canal. Nasser launched a surprise attack, that basically took it over and nationalized it as an Egyptian asset. This little video gives us a little clip about that period of time, if it works, hopefully.
A new Middle East crisis arises as President Nasser of Egypt tells a wildly cheering crowd in Alexandria that Egypt has seized the internationally owned Suez Canal. His announcement touches off a rapid series of reprisals and counter-reprisals. Britain freezes all Egyptian funds, and Egypt retaliates with the same measures. France lodges a bitter protest and suggests military action. The 85-year-old waterway, of which the United States is the second biggest user, brings a three-power meeting in London to discuss the biggest threat this year has posed to world peace.
Okay. Nothing like a good old news clip, eh, to bring a bit of life to the story. Well, when that happened and NASA took over the Suez Canal, immediately the Western powers are put on the back foot. The British and the French immediately wanted to go into recapture it, but the UN stood against it, okay? Russia and Soviet Union and the US were against any military action. But the British and the French and the IDF launched a strike attack aimed at taking back the Suez Canal. So you've got to remember, this was in Israel's interest, of course, because the Suez Canal was pivotal to them getting cargo through to Haifa and to Tel Aviv. And one of Egypt's things was, when they took it over, that there would be no Israeli ships allowed through that area at all. Blanket statement. So it was very directive as to what NASA's intent was, and that was to control Israel again. So they launched this strike into taking the Suez Canal, and basically within 5 days, the IDF and their tank forces had moved all the way through the Sinai Peninsula to the Suez Canal. The French had already landed paratroopers into it, and the British into Gaza, and had taken and basically expelled Egypt out of that whole area. But the UN put pressure onto them to stop, because they had not been given a UN sanction for this war, and they had to back out. And so even though Egypt had lost the war, they had won the political war. And Nasser, out of that, got this amazing fame throughout the Arab nations, that he really was the hero of them that had defeated the West. He had defeated Britain, he had defeated France, and he had defeated their baby, Israel. And so he just rose to this star of fame amongst the Syrians, amongst the Jordans, and in Egypt. And so that becomes the background then to the 1967 war. We've got a man who rules over a population of about 30 million people in Egypt. You've got the other Arabs that were involved in the Six-Day War, Jordan and Syria, who bring this total up to about 39 million people that were banding behind Nasser and his aggressive actions towards the nation of Israel. In Israel, you've got a population at this stage of 2.7 million. Now, that's a huge increase, isn't it, when you think of what happened in 1948. They had 806,000, and now they've got up another 2 million, and that's all through this immigration, because they now had control of their own homeland, and bringing those people in, forming into the kibbutzes, and making a nation that were again coming alive, just like that tree sprouting to life. Well, the Arab nations formed their powers and their military might on the borders of Israel. The UN that was put into the Sinai area was told to leave as Egypt came in and brought their troops onto the boundaries of the land of Israel. This is in early 1967. So here they are. The Egyptians have moved from this side of the Suez Canal, where my red pointer is, and now they've come right up to the border of where Israel is. This had, as a part of the 1956 Suez Crisis, that had been controlled by the UN. They were told to leave. The Jordanians moved their troops into this area. The Syrians moved their troops in towards the Golan Heights. Was there any doubt that there was going to be a war? The world knew there was going to be a war. Israel was quickly developing or putting together all their resources ready for a war. The bunkers, the food, the supplies, the blood donors, the hospitals, they were all made ready for a war that was imminent. On the 19th of May, NASA made a declaration and then followed it up with putting boats down here that cut off what's called the Straits of Tehran. So he's got control here of the Suez Canal. He's now blocked off the Straits of Tehran. That means no boats can get up here to the bottom of Israel, which is where Eilat is. No boats can come through this way into the Mediterranean to Israel. Israel had already said, if that happens, then we see that as a declaration of war. President Nasser had, as it were, signed the war warrant. Having said that, he was sitting back, believing confidently that he was in full control of what was going to happen. He had the numbers. He had the armies. In fact, the Jordanian army had already asked for the Egyptians to take over the leadership of their army. Such was the confidence in the Egyptian leadership. Such was the confidence of the Egyptians in themselves. Israel knew they had to launch a surprise attack if they were going to overcome such military odds. And so on the 5th of June, in what's known as the Operation Focus, the IAF committed 95% of their air force into a surprise attack onto the Egyptian, the Jordanian, and the Syrian air force. You see here where my red line is, an arrow that goes out over the sea, the Mediterranean Sea, and comes in here into the areas of Port Said and back further through to Cairo. That's where the Israeli Air Force flew at low altitude, undetected by the radars of the Egyptians, and came in and basically wiped out 300 of the Egyptian Air Force and bombed their runways and made their Air Force pretty much inoperable, doing the same to the Jordanians and the Syrians. And in an action that lasted pretty much the full day, they were able to take supremacy of the skies so that the Israeli Air Force, though far less in number, actually had control of the battle. Now, that's a huge thing when you've got land forces, because now the sky can back up what the land forces are doing without having to worry about protecting themselves. At the same time as Israel launched their air attack, in the Sinai area here where Egyptians had massed their forces, Ariel Sharon and Israel Tel led the campaign of tanks in the Sinai area. In the first day, they wiped out the whole air force of the Egyptians, a lot of damage to the Jordanians and Syrian air force as well, and were deep into Sinai. At the same time as this was happening, the Jordanian army started to launch their guns onto the Jerusalem quarters that were inhabited by the Jews and into the IDF areas around Jerusalem. The battle for Jerusalem began. Now on the second day, the battle intensity in the central area around Jerusalem was being driven, obviously it was driven by this desire to capture Jerusalem, as well as the West Bank and that whole area that in the Battle of Independence had been left to Jordanian control. But the battles were hard, the battles were severe. And it came back to some of the same areas where the battles of 1948 happened, a place called Ammunition Hill. As far as trenching and as far as being defended, it was a fortress. And they were on the back foot, the IDF, to come in to take this, because it was already held by the Jordanians. In the end of that battle, they ended up losing 37 of the IDF and 106 of the Jordanians, which is an amazing thing to think, given the numbers that were behind the Jordanians, that the Israelis were able to come up and to take that area. It's not amazing, because there was a purpose behind it. These soldiers were heading towards Jerusalem, and God had a time frame that now was the time for that city to be taken. Such was the intensity and the surprise of the attacks in Sinai that the Egyptians started retreating. This was the largest Arab army, and here it was already on the second day, retreating back through the Sinai in disarray. In the third day, they were discussing a ceasefire in the UN. Moshe Dayan, the commander of the Israeli forces, which you probably know by the man with the eye patch, He heard that and knew that he had to immediately set his forces upon taking the old city of Jerusalem, lest a ceasefire comes in and the opportunity was lost again. God was with them. On that day, the third day of the 6 days, the city of Jerusalem was taken. The old city of Jerusalem was taken by the IDF. And here at the walls of Jerusalem, of Herod's temple, the place where so many Jews come to pray, is a picture of the rabbi of the IDF there, blowing the shofar, calling his men to prayer in the middle of a war. Such was the rejoicing of them taking this holy city of Jerusalem. It was their heart. It was their soul. It was really what they wanted to make the center of their nation again. Here's just a little video that picks up some of the joy that was felt as the people realized they had taken again the city of Jerusalem. There's no audio on that.
The fighting over, thousands of joyous civilians, students and troops streamed toward the Mandelbaum gates. It's the first, without doubt, the most personally moving moment for Israeli troops was the capture of the old city of Jerusalem, the location of an ancient Jewish holy place revered by the Israelis. The fighting over, thousands of joyous civilians, students and troops streamed toward the Mandelbaum gates. It's the first time in 19 years that Jews have been allowed to visit and pray at the site of the ancient Temple of Solomon. Jordan had kept the old city barricaded since the declaration of Israeli independence. It was here that Israeli troops acted more like tourists than fighting men, obviously in awe of their surroundings. The sacred Wailing Wall, where Israeli Defense Minister General Moshe Dayan prays, pledging never to give up the old city. While Russia and other Iron Curtain countries label Israel's victory as aggression, insisting she pull back to original boundaries, Israeli Premier Eshkol, equally adamant, insists Israel alone will determine her
their destiny, I think is what it's meant to say, but given that it's a free thing, maybe you have to put up with the word being left out. But basically here you could see, couldn't you, the joy that was felt, not only by the IDF, but by the inhabitants of Israel after this war was finished, that they had finally taken and held this holy city of Jerusalem. And in verse 24 of Luke 21, it says, Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And here on the third day, of the 6 day war, Jerusalem, for the first time in 1900 years, was again in its completeness under the control of the Jewish people. It was a fulfillment of Bible prophecy, but it was also a flag for us to know that the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is near. Just quickly, the war goes on in the fourth day in the south. So, in the Sinai Peninsula, they continue on down to take right down here at what's called Shem El Sheikh. That is where the Egyptians had blocked off the Straits of Tyran. They took out that city. They took out the guns. They made sure that area, that the Straits of Tyran were open again so that the cargo ships and that could go up to Elat and to service the nation of Israel from the south. Now, the fifth day becomes another interesting one. So let's just put up here the first 4 days on the Sinai. Whoops. Against Egypt. First 3 days here we'll put in Jerusalem, which is the Jordanians. And up until this point here, there hadn't been a lot in the north, which is where Syria was. There'd been a couple of incursions, but they'd been driven back by the IDF. But now the talk in the UN was seriously about peace. How are we going to finish this war? Israel had already tried to settle up here in the north, but had constantly been bombarded by the Syrians, or shot at by the Syrians, as they tried to establish the agricultural land in the north. The Golan Heights has got an elevation of about 500 metres, on which you can look down to the Sea of Galilee and the surrounding areas, and they could take off and make a hard life for those that were trying to set up the kibbutzes there. So thanks to the work of Eli Cohen, the Israelis were loaded with information about the defences as to how the Syrians were set up on the Golan Heights. Now was the decision. Were we going to use this information to continue to grow our country? And they did. In those last 2 days, they forced their way up those hills with their tanks, with their paramilitary troopers, and worked their way up to take what's known as the Golan Heights. Over the top of every defence place, well, not every, but a lot of them, was a nice eucalyptus tree. So as you're going through the dust and the bullets of war, there you have the marker as to where the defences of the Syrians were. So the work of Eli Cohen was directing them through and helping them as they took and established this area. So we see there at the end of 6 days, the nation of Israel went from what is there in the purple area to taking those areas which are also in the striped areas. So Sinai, right down here to the Straits of Tyran. The whole West Bank, including Jerusalem, was under their control, as well as in the north, the Golan Heights. A miraculous victory. Without doubt, it was God's time for the Gentiles to be eradicated from the city of Jerusalem. It's exciting, it's interesting, isn't it? That's the growth of that nation. That's the tree that is sprouting forth. And of course, there's other nations that we could follow through that sign and look at their sprouting forth through this period of time, but God points us to the fig tree. And we've looked at that over the last 4 nights. Different ways that fig tree has started to sprout. And here in such a direct prophecy about the city of Jerusalem that pointed to God's peace being taken again by the hands of his people, to remind you and to remind me that pointed to peace is speaking about God's faithfulness and commitment to completing his promises, not just to his people, but to everyone. The kingdom of God is coming. The kingdom of God is near. Now, Luke 21 is both a comforting and at the same time an exhortational prophecy, isn't it? Let's just read those words that we've got up there on the screen. So you also, when you see these things happen, know that the kingdom of God is near. Assuredly, I say unto you, this generation will by no means pass away till all things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. This generation that sees these signs, they can look up and know that their redemption is drawing near. But at the same time, they live in an age which is full of perplexity. Verse 25, distress amongst nations, waves roaring. In verse 34, the overcharging of excessiveness and drunkenness and cares of this life. And amongst that, this sign has been given. And we're told to watch and to pray. This sign has been given to tell us to sift all that other distraction out of our vision and to take confidence that you and I, as a part of this generation, will see the return of our Lord Jesus Christ, the King of Jerusalem. So we've had a very exciting visit to the modern day of Israel. Thank definitely much our brother Steve for his work in putting that timeline together that we've seen. The fishers and the hunters. And then not just him, but Uncle Jeff come in and taking on a subject that he absolutely loves to stir us up. And hopefully all of us have been stirred up by seeing and reminding ourselves of the sureness of the Word of God and the prophecies we have, but also the excitement that we do live in that generation, God willing, that will soon see the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks.
Thanks, Phil, for your enthusiasm and thoughts tonight. It's really appreciated. And thank you, both Phil and Steve, just reiterating what Phil said. It's been great to have these series, and there's a lot of work that's gone into it, so thank you both for that. Just a few announcements. Next B, we are going to start a series on first principles, and particularly the promises in Eden. Matt Wigsall is doing that, Trevor's the chair, and Ellie is the reader. Andy is the pianist, and Johnny Phyllis is the streaming. Steve and Louise Atkins are meant to be coordinating supper, and that Red Group can help them out as well. We're going to close with hymn and prayer now, and our closing hymn is 379. Our Father, the great God of the nations, who works in powers far beyond we can see. We've seen your hand work, Father, and create miracles. Things that people could never see happening, your hand has made and made come about. Please help us, Father, to appreciate that not only do you have the power to do that in nations, but you have that to do, that power to change men's hearts as well. You change our own hearts to ones that love you and fear you and follow your characteristics. Please help us, Father, to appreciate that and to understand that and to live it. And Father, we've seen your people fight their wars and you support them through the wars in Jerusalem. And Father, we pray for that day when they will recognize you as the power behind them. That day when they will appreciate your hand working in their life, the power of the promises that you made to Abraham so long ago, and your long-suffering and mercy towards them. We pray for that day, Father, where they will see your Son and they will be sorry for the pain and the suffering that they have brought to him. We pray for that day, Father, when their hearts will be changed, just as our heart has to be changed. To trust in you, to rely on you for strength and protection. And Father, we pray for that day where Jerusalem not only will point to peace, but will be the centre of peace, where your righteousness will be shown throughout the world, because only once this is done can there really be peace. Please help us, Father, to live that righteousness, live your characteristics in our hearts now, so that that peace that we will experience will be with us now. We pray for that day soon when your Son will return. And it's through his name that we pray at this time. Amen.